I was a young man with a dream in a small, struggling design studio. I also did illustration and photography. I had a particular interest in fashion, dance, and music. I even dabbled with the comic book, The Adventures of High McNoonan. One day, my wife told me she was pregnant. I needed a steady job. A friend gave me an alphabetical list of companies that hired artists. Top of the list, Abel, Robert & Associates. I had no idea what they did. I made an appointment to show them my work and got a job as an art director right on the spot. I was thrust into the exciting world of advertising and threw myself into the daunting task of becoming familiar with ad concepts. It's not what you sell, but how you sell it. I learned the basics of special effects, the sound large chrome type makes in space, to always look for the unexpected and never get involved in political advertising. It was the dawn of the digital age, and our work would shape the buying habits of millions. Endless hours became endless days, became endless weeks. I absorbed as much as my colleagues would share with me. One day, Bob came to my office and set a project on my table. He said, "Here you go. This one's all yours." And just like that, I was a director. First of all, thank you all for coming. I'm sorry I couldn't be there. It would have been great to catch up with my friends and colleagues from the studio and see what they're all up to. I'm sure you guys are going to have a great time this evening. First spot I'd like to talk to you about is Brilliance. It's a spot that's better known as Sexy Robot. And it was something the studio tackled in late 1984 to be shown one time in the 1985 Super Bowl. It incorporated everything the studio knew up to that point and quite a few things we had never even experimented with. The first and the most difficult being human motion. There was no motion capture situations at this point. Basically, what we did is we pointed three cameras at a model, had her go through the motions, and then we had to, like, literally by brute force, put the motion together by comparing different angles. Very, very labor intensive. The second difficult problem was getting the human form itself. We had always worked with pretty simple geometric shapes up to this point. And this is the first time we had to do extremely complex 3D compound shapes. And that proved very, very difficult. Again, a very steep learning curve. All the trails we blazed on this probably will never be used again. But it was what we had to do at that time to get the data into the computer. And the third, which was pretty easy in comparison, was getting everything to look like chrome. And again, we'd done a lot of chrome type, a lot of chrome, different things in chrome. But wrapping it around a really complex 3D shape was something that we had never even tackled before. So we really had to manipulate the reflection maps and make sure that everything was looking like it was chrome. And as simple as that might have sounded, it actually posed a lot of problems in the end. Anyway, a lot of people worked very, very long and hard on this. Tim McGovern was the lead TD, and he literally almost worked himself into the hospital. It was a very, very difficult spot for him and for most everybody involved. My most vivid memory of the spot was being in Bob's office with the entire agency, and I was standing there with them screaming at me, and I'm not exaggerating, they were screaming. It was a week before deadline, they thought they were gonna lose their jobs, and this was, in retrospect, pretty typical of any Able production. But we pulled it off at the end, which we always seem to do. It played one time to great success, and in the end, everybody was happy and took ownership and authorship of it. So we did make a making of film, which I'd like to present now.
Even in the year 3000, the question will be, what's for dinner?
Commercials are as much a part of our popular culture as movies and television. Perhaps because the best commercials provide the same kind of entertainment. This is the story of the making of the commercial called Brilliance, an extraordinary look at a very ordinary product. Created by Ketchum Advertising, it was produced by Robert Abel and Associates.
Thought we wanted to do something that was so image-oriented and so striking that you kind of dispelled all the rumors about cans that you know. And we came up with a presenter who we like to call HM, and a rather simple board of 8 frames to tell a very simple story of what's for dinner.
When we saw this board, I said, we've got to do this board because, and at the same time I'm saying this, I'm scared because I don't know if we can do the board. So this, you know, this is a classic story of a commercial that can't and shouldn't be made, but it's like the little engine that could, and we're gonna do it.
Well, people have a preconceived idea of what computer commercials look like, and this is gonna break out of all of those molds. I mean, it's a real step, it's a quantum leap as far as commercials.
The reason we chose Randy Roberts to direct this thing was that Randy has done so much work that we always thought was impossible, and he always proved us wrong.
Yeah, it's this kind of detail, this early space vehicle. Yeah, because it kicks light up well, and that's another thing we'll have to experiment with is the way some of these surfaces are affected by light.
The first step was to translate that two-dimensional image that we see on the storyboard into one that works in 3 dimensions in the computer. And that takes a lot more redesign than it looks at first glance, because we had to build the robot and her environment in pieces. It means everything from the smallest finger joint to the torso to the neck to the body parts, the leg, the arm, 18 pieces had to be put together and created for the computer. This entire image really never existed outside the computer itself.
And so you chose on her, instead of the helmet, to just kind of go with one piece, sort of. It looks a little more like almost Egyptian.
Yeah, the thing with that is, in order to get this type of a helmet on, it has to be back on the head and tilted. And it's like when you do that here, it looks like a woman sitting under a hairdryer.
Once we had the design, we used a foam mannequin to give real shape to the robot. The foam was sliced into cross sections, and each outline was then programmed and fed digitally into the computer and stored as information.
How's that?
That's pretty good. Okay, now the bottom lip looks a little thick. Maybe we should take...
Can I translate them all up a little?
Yeah, maybe from like 25 to 34 or something. Okay, well, I think that looks better.
To be something where you really can't tell if she's real or if she's computerized. Her movements are very human, and she's very sexy but very strong, and you've got to believe it's a human being, yet it isn't quite. It just couldn't be with the way the look of her body.
The biggest unknown was making her move and bringing her to life. Randy invented a technique he called brute force animation. We filmed a live model and programmed her choreographed movements into the computer. The computer tracked reference points painted on her body and created a stick figure animation, which we call a vector graphic.
The motion is all set up hierarchical, so that wherever we move her torso, her arms all go with it, in addition to the motion of the body, so that it has more of the characteristics of the way her body motion is, the way it accelerates and decelerates, and the way it holds at the right places, and when things start and stop.
Once we got the motion right, we used raster graphics to give the image form and color. The robot, her movements, the details, each reflection, the magic she does with the food, getting all of that into an environment and then adding Jupiter into the picture window. Well, that's millions of bits of information that the computer has to chew through. If you can imagine, each picture of film, which is a 24th of a second, takes 10,000 or 20,000, add, multiply, subtracts, divides. And on top of this, we're writing new software on a daily basis to speed this up. You get an idea that we're combining some science and technology with the ultimate in improvisation.
What happened here? Is this reflection?
That's before the reflection program was fixed.
Okay, so this is a composite frame that we've already saved.
Put it together.
Okay. In the last month, we put 3 computers online around the clock to ensure the fact that we'd make that Super Bowl due date. Because we could output directly to 1-inch videotape, we could literally take images off the computer and hand carry them to the edit session in stages.
Well, the thing that holds up is the joints. That's why this was...
Naturally, we're incredibly proud of the results, but you get so close to an actor or to a performance, or in this case, to our friend that we called Sexy Robot, that we and the Ketchum Advertising Group just held our breath as we showed it to the client.
Even in the year 3000, the question will be, what's for dinner? The answer will be in a package that saves energy, nutrients, and trouble. A package that can last the 3-year journey to Jupiter and back and back. Even in the year 3000, we see the brilliance of food in cans.
God, you know, the wonderful thing about it is the human way that she moves. And it's very smooth, very, very, very fluid.
If somebody says, on Sunday evening, the 20th of January, who won the Super Bowl? And they say, I don't know, but I saw this 30-second commercial.
Then we know we got it.
Then you know you've really achieved
something. Absolutely. You bet.
The next spot I'd like to talk about is Hawaiian Punch. Hawaiian Punch was produced in 1985, and it advanced the techniques that we had discovered and pioneered in the making of Brilliance. We had already tackled and accomplished some of the goals that were involved in this production, so it gave us a little more time to delve into things like character and personality. We didn't kill it, but it's like, still, we didn't have to tackle the motion and the chrome surfaces and things like that. We had that down. So this was our first foray into giving the characters a little more something than just, accomplishing the motion from point A to point B. We gave them a little specialness in between. Also, up to this point, all computer graphics were absolutely pristine. No dings, no dents, no scratches. It was all as if everything was made in this perfect world. Real world wasn't like that. And we also wanted to get the idea across that this factory was maybe up and running. It's been, in existence for 30, 40 years, and not everything was working as perfectly as it should. So we developed a technique where we would, usually we just apply a surface to the geometry. Well, in this case, we actually painted the surfaces and applied those to the geometry. And so we kind of put the nicks and the dings and the scratched paint and all that into the painting so that it wasn't as intensive as far as the computational power that it took to create that. So it was our first kind of cheat in a way of camouflaging the perfection of CGI. There was also a live action component in the spot, and this was the first time I ever got to direct live action. We brought in choreographers and musicians. We shot the live action on a big stage that no longer exists. It burned down in 5 years later or so. But it was a 400-foot stage, and we were able to rear project the animation, the computer animation, on a very, very large rear screen projection that we had synced and timed to the music. This was also the first time that I'd contacted Mark Mothersbaugh from Devo and asked him if he'd like to get involved in doing the music for the spot. So we brought in a lot of different creative people, and the result was a lot of fun. And at the time, it was very, very cutting edge. We're going to show it to you now, and it looks very, very dated, but again, it's like not all these things weather all that well. So here's Hawaiian Punch, and I hope you enjoy it. Thank you. I want to leave you with the original concept drawings and the storyboards to a short film we did called High Fidelity. This is something that we did as kind of our first foray into raster graphics. We didn't really have anything to show the world what we could do. So I presented this idea to Bob, and as Bob is usually prone to do, he blessed it, and we set off and did it. It was really, the intention was to put it out and show people where the technology had gone. This predates Brilliance, and it predates Hawaiian Punch. So we were dealing with very, very simple shapes, and the geometry is not that big a deal, and the lighting is pretty straightforward. But we had a lot of fun with it. We used it as an idea of cutting edge design. So the colors and the textures and the music and all that kind of stuff was really just supposed to be a light, fun piece. Anyway, the original drawing was based a cone character and a cylinder character embracing, you know, jungle setting. And then I'd also been working with some ideas of what was once described as dancing wallpaper, for lack of a better term. What, not my term, but somebody looked at it and said that's what it was, and it stuck. So here are the drawings, and we'll put a little piece of music underneath it so you can just sit back and enjoy it. And I know that we're going to close the show with this piece, so you'll be able to compare the storyboards to the final piece. Anyway, again, thank you all for coming. Good night, and again, sorry I couldn't be there.